गुड मॉर्निंग सर, गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर ब्रिज एन सिंह एंड गुड वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स हु आर अटेंडिंग द IEEE PELS डिस्टिंग्विश्ड लेक्चर ऑन वाइड बैंड गैप पावर इलेक्ट्रॉनिक सिस्टम्स फॉर हेवी ड्यूटी व्हीकल्स. टुडे आवर स्पीकर इज अवेलेबल डॉक्टर ब्रिज एन सिंह. He is a technical fellow, power electronics engineering in John Deere, USA. He has earned BE degree in electrical engineering from Madan Mohan Malviya Technical University, Gorakhpur, and ME degree from IIT Roorkee, and PhD degree from Indian Institute of Technology, New Delhi, India. In 1996, Dr. Singh joined the in Canada as a postdoctoral fellow. In 1999, he joined Concordia University, Canada as a research fellow. In the year 2000, he joined the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science in Toulon University as an assistant professor. In 2007, Dr. Singh has joined John Deere, USA as a power electronics staff engineer, where he has led and supported power electronics technology development projects for 644 and 944 hybrid loaders electrification. In 2011, he joined John Deere Advanced Technology Development and has executed R&D projects related to high temperature, power dense, high efficiency power electronic systems, including wide band gap power conversion technologies. In the year September 2020, Dr. Singh was named as John Deere Region 4 Public Funding Manager with job title as R4 Manager External Relationships. Dr. Singh is tasked to lead John Deere emerging technology projects, including successful execution of government and non-government funded projects in collaboration with universities, government labs, and industries. Emerging technology projects led by Dr. Singh are likely to be applicable to John Deere tech stack, production systems, product lifecycle systems, construction, and road building. The various projects led by Dr. Singh are destined to reduce the greenhouse gas emission and carbon footprint reduction, the resulting in a sustainable environment for the society. Dr. Singh has published over 90 research papers in various journals, including IEEE Transactions and IET journals. He has 28 approved US patents, one trade secret, and over a dozen pending patents. In Toulon, Dr. Singh received 4 IEEE NU Teaching Awards for Outstanding Instructions in Electrical Engineering. In John Deere, he has received 3 innovation and 1 collaboration award for the product and technology development works. Dr. Singh is the winner of the 2020 IEEE Power Electronics Emerging Technology Award. In February 2020, Dr. Singh was awarded the title of John Deere Fellow for exemplary contributions to the power electronics engineering. He is a senior member of the IEEE and lives with his family in North America, USA. So we heartily welcome you, sir, for today's IEEE PELS Distinguished Lecture. Participants, it's you can take the knowledge from Dr. Breeze Ken Singh for the lecture, Wide Band Gap Power Electronic Systems for Heavy Duty Vehicles. We heartily welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Satish, for kind introduction. Yeah, so Thanks for all having me here today with you. And I would be talking about wide bandgap power electronic system for heavy duty vehicle. John Deere is known for producing, ag, this is turf care vehicle like golf course, lawn mowing, this is tractor, this is planter, this is a utility vehicle, I think, and this is construction mining vehicle. And I don't have a picture for forestry vehicle, but we do make vehicle that's forestry application, like cutting trees and all that. And then we have a huge presence in construction vehicle, road building. There's a company called Baltican Corporation. About 4 or 5 years ago, we wrote $7 billion check to that company, and we bought that, and overnight we became largest company in the world for providing construction road building machinery. So we kept the name as a Baltican Corporation, and it has huge presence in China and India. So I will be talking a little bit about myself, who I am, and you did some introduction, but there's one relevant engineering aspect of my life. So it would be interesting to know that John Deere company, and then the unit I am part of John Deere Intelligence Solution Group. So last year, John Deere went massive reorganization. What that means is you basically throw 70,000 employees in the air and let them free fall, and wherever they fall, that's their new job, right? So it was really, really, John Deere is a 185-year-old company. They never did such a massive reorganization. And in that process, a lot of people lost their job, and I was lucky to be remain, you know, employed in Deere and company. And then wide bank of technology, silicon carbide inverter technology development work that I did since 2014 time frame, vehicle testing, and our finding followed by summary. So this is me. I was born, brought up in India. You know, I'm from Uttar Pradesh, India, and all my degrees are from India. Then in 1996, I immigrated to North America. And as I said, my degrees are from India. Then I went to ETS, called Cold Technology. Cold Technology, Montreal. And if someone of you can admit the people who are in the waiting, I don't need to click that mouse. So this could do that. So then I had a postdoctoral fellow, so did a lot of power quality related work. My one of the distinguished lecturer presentation is on the power quality. This is today we are talking about vehicle electrification of powertronics. Then I was in Concordia University where I developed some advanced power converters. Then went to join Tulane University, New Orleans. There I did, you know, research related to power system application of power electronics. Has National Science Foundation funding, which is like a Department of Science Technology funding, DST funding in India. In the US, there's a NSF that funds basic science research and industry funding and all that. I graduated 2 PhD students, a lot of master students, and a lot of Bachelor of Science Engineering students, you know, they're my students. They are doing extremely well in their life. One of them became plastic surgeon. You can imagine plastic surgery is, surgeons are highly paid in the US. And then the staff, then I joined Deere with progress. And now I'm region 4 manager for external relationship, which is basically my responsibility are to operate in US, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. So this is me, and as I said, I'm Northern India. So as you know, in North India, summer gets very, very warm, right? 123 degree Fahrenheit, which is roughly 50 degrees Celsius. Then I came to Montreal, there it gets as cold as minus 45. So you see the temperature change of about 95 degrees C. Then I went to New Orleans, where temperature gets as warm as 45 degrees C, hot, humid, and all that. So again, you see the temperature difference of over 85 degrees C. And now I'm in Fargo, North Dakota, where in winter, it gets minus 65 degrees C. So it's much colder than Siachen Glacier in India because of the wind. It's a plain land and northerly wind from North Pole come and, you know, cool it down all this northern US and Canada, and it remains frozen for 4 plus 5 months. So you see the huge delta T everywhere. That's exactly power electronics is in the vehicle application. Anytime you apply the power, you get temperature change, and that's what makes the powertrain break down. So if you understand this, phenomena, then you can design very good high quality power converters. The design I did for John Deere has seen 75 million field hour and not a single failure. So I'm so proud of the work I did for Deere for production vehicles. So this is basically Deere slogan, which is basically John Deere is a world leader in providing advanced products and services and is committed to the success of those linked to the land. So basically we have ag vehicle, agriculture vehicle, forestry, mining, construction, road building, turf care. So anything, any vehicle we make, one way or other, it touches ground. That's why we say those linked to the land. And okay, so these are four core values: integrity, quality, commitment, innovation. So integrity is basically we do business in right ways, you know. Quality is that we care for the product we make, they are high quality. And the commitment means do say and do ratio, right? So say less, do more. And innovation, we continue keep innovating. So that's why John Deere is 185-year-old company, but is still in business and going very strong, much, much further ahead with our nearest competition. So John Deere today, you know, it's a global, you know, this is our construction vehicle, this is ag vehicle, and these are huge, huge monster vehicle, huge size. This is turf care vehicle, and which is basically mowing the grass in the golf course and all that. And essentially, this has a lot of power converters. Actually, these reels, the grass cutting reels, are driven by power converter head electric machine, driven by, you know, really driven by electric machine. This is actually a forestry vehicle called Feller Venture. So pretty much you grab the tree by these arms and then there's a saw underneath, then it cuts the tree and then it cuts to the length, and there would be another vehicle on side here that basically the tree is just put there. And think about this vehicle is driving on non-paved. So there's no road and nothing, right? And you are driving it in such a situation. So these vehicles are operating under extremely harsh environment. Then we have some supporting business. The unit I am part of is a supporting business called the Intelligent Solutions Group, ISG. So here there's a display and then this is a planter, right? And you basically, we plant 35,000 seed per acre. And essentially we count them as seed drops in the trench. We take the temperature of the soil, and we do the chemistry, soil chemistry. We know the fertilizer. We apply the chemical. We take the picture of each seed that you put on the ground. We collect a lot of data, and then we care for each plant by plant management of, you know, agriculture product. And there's a lot of power electronics that is enabling this thing. Then we have worldwide part services. So anything you bought from Deere, even if you bought 1940 tractor, we would have part for you. It's not that we would turn you away. Hey, it's too old, we can't repair. We would repair. If you have a, no matter how old vehicle you have, we have part for you. Financial services. So we provide loan to those company that buy your product. Power system is actually division where we make engines. We design and we make engine. And now with the carbon free society, by 2050 world need to be carbon neutral. So there's a lot of focus underway on the low carbon intensity fuel or zero carbon fuel and things like that. So that work, very advanced work, is happening in John Deere Power System division. So ISG Fargo, the unit I joined Deere in 2007, used to call Phoenix International. It was founded to develop a ruggedized powertrains for off-road application. So here we make embedded controller. Any vehicle has many, many such controller. And then powertrains display, a vehicle has a lot of display and real time. It is giving operator what is happening, how many seeds per acre you are planting, how fast you are going, what is your fuel consumption. And when you are harvesting, you basically take the picture, grain by grain, you take the picture. and you calculate the protein content in the grain, and then you decide the this is the value of the grain that farmer is harvesting, and real time he can trade that this is the value of, like, for example, when corn is dumped in ethanol plant, right? So moisture and all that is very, very important. So we have a lot of sensors, camera, you know, all that, that does that job, automated job. Wireless communication, all our vehicles are wired through communication link. And this was extremely useful under COVID situation, that we were able to push out the upgrade. We were able to remotely diagnose any problem in the vehicle, repair it. 99% problem are repaired remotely. No matter you are 1,000 miles away, we can repair your vehicle. Usually there's a software issue, but if there's a hardware problem, then someone can go and fix it. Then we have a sensing solution, which is a lot of vehicles. These vehicles have a lot of sensors, camera, and perceptions, and all that aspect of this. So this is the vehicle I designed when I started working. So it's a 944 loader. It's a mining vehicle. So the ground torque of this vehicle is 1 million Newton meter. So how it is counted, basically each wheel has a, you know, a motor. There's a motor here, switch reluctance machine driven by power converter. That motor has a 2500 Newton meter torque, and there are four of them. So 2500 times four, you're talking about 800, and then peak torque is roughly 1 million Newton meter. So this vehicle, like, it drives about 300-400 kilometer per hour, it can fly, but it is not made to fly. This is workhorse, and it consumes 11 gallon diesel per hour. So now you multiply 11 times 3.7, because in 1 gallon about 3.7 liter. So you now do the math, roughly 40 liter per hour fuel consumption this vehicle has. And you know, if this goes down for some reason, there's a 3,000 per hour loss productivity. So performance productivity is extremely important. So my handprint, mind prints are in this vehicle. The electronics and power lines I designed for this vehicle has seen roughly, you know, about by this time, 75 million field hour, and not a single failure. So I'm so proud of doing the electronics for this vehicle. This is architecture for this vehicle. So essentially there are four electric machines, one on each wheel. It's a 100 kilowatt machine. And then there are twin generators. These are driven by engine. And that engine is about 600 horsepower engine. And then there are converter. There are six converter here. So there are three converter on one DC bus, and there are three converter other DC bus. So we have basically a split drive system, because if one converter set goes down, still you can climb up like maybe 200, 300 feet below ground, and nobody is going to tow you out, right? So you want to basically drive it away and to take the repair facility. These are electric power resistors. So anytime this vehicle slows down, DC bus goes above 700 volt bus, 750 or so. So we dump the extra power, regenerated power, into the brake resistor. So this is a link that if you click in there, you will see the history by one customer that, you know, industry leading reliability. So another benefit of electrification or putting power converters in this vehicle is this. Control system prevents near zero speed tire spin and slicing. So since this is a mining operation, and the tire can slip, and if it slips, then it causes what you call tire tear and wear, and one tire costs $10,000. So it's roughly $1 million vehicle, so $40,000 per tire. So you want to make sure that even tire, and that we never thought that can, by doing electrification, putting power converter in the vehicle, put up, you know, traction system, can be, you know, increase the longevity of the tire. And indeed it was, and that was huge value for John Deere customer. Then 6-foot loader, it's also hybrid loader, and we have a non-hybrid version of 6-foot loader. So what happens, control system allows application maximum power where it is needed the most. So when you are pushing the vehicle in the pile of the dirt, coal, or whatever, it could be dust, and then you can apply the power when you are driving it very high speed, 40 kilometer per hour. Then you apply the power into the speeding traction. So here what happens, we decouple the vehicle traction system from engine speed, and that was huge deal. That itself allowed us to downsize engine of the vehicle from 9 liter engine to 6.8 liter engine. So engine drive the generator almost fixed speed, and then the converter, feed the electric machine, and then a digital transmission system. So this vehicle doesn't have a wheel-mounted motors, but there's a three-speed transmission system. And what essentially it does, it basically replaces the power converter fed electric machine has replaced traditional torque converter. So what torque converter is, that's imagine that you are converting power into energy, right? So at zero speed, power doesn't exist. We know, right? Power is torque times the speed. So if you generate a lot of power, bring down the speed at that power turns into energy. So it's like energy to power conversion type, work this torque converter does, which is very bad of doing the work. So why don't you run engine at a constant speed, very sweet spot at a highest efficiency point, and let the power converter fed electric machine takes care of the vehicle work. And this vehicle is such a nicely designed, and so are 9 foot 4 also, that operator doesn't need to apply mechanical brake if you want, right? It does itself. So that's why operator is more effective doing the work. And as I said earlier, productivity and performance, that's what matters the most for the people. And fuel economy, it comes along, that's okay. But if work need to be done, work need to be done. Nobody cares about the cost of fuel. They care about their work. So then this is the architecture of the 6-4-4 loader. So essentially, because I get to ask this question very often, that okay, these are hybrid vehicle, so what is the size of the battery? So this diagram has very good explanation. Indeed, there's no battery, because 6-9-4-4 loader consumes at 40 liter diesel per hour. 6-4-4 consumes roughly, I would say 18 liter per hour. So there's no battery that you can basically do and work 18, 20 hours a day. So single charge, you just cannot find the size of the battery. And even if you did, the size of battery would be 3 times the vehicle size. So nobody will buy such a product. So essentially what it is, diesel engine drive the generator with the gearbox. So engine runs top speed of engine 1800 RPM, generator 3 times higher. So 5400 RPM at a fixed speed usually. And then you have power converter, then you have multi-speed traction system. And then you have a power register just in case if there is some issue. DC bus climbs beyond 750 volt, you burn that energy into power register. So this is electrical circuit. And we have tested our silicon carbide inverter world-class power electronics in this vehicle. By the way, if you are interested asking any question middle of my presentation, please feel free. You can type in chat window. I hope I get, or otherwise one of the moderator, and I can put chat on this side, so I would know that if somebody asking any question. So now I will switch over gear towards the wide-bandgap powertrain. So this was government-funded project that I was lucky enough to participate, and that allowed me to do this very advanced powertronics. So before going into the project details, let me talk a little bit about what is wide-bandgap semiconductor and what is wide-bandgap powertronics. So if you look at the attributes of silicon carbide and gallium nitride semiconductor, in terms of electric breakdown field, energy gap between conduction band, valence band, and saturated electron velocity, electron mobility, thermal conductivity, then you see that the, as compared to silicon, these two materials are far, far better. As a result of that, for a given voltage, because it is wider band gap, silicon carbide and gallium nitride, electric field with the stand capability is much, much higher. So what that means is you can make the chip, you know, power semiconductor chip much, much thinner. And oftentimes 5 to 10 times thinner than the what you did in case of silicon. And what that means is there's a lot less distance to be traveled from drain to source. And as you all know, that the resistance is a function of distance traveled, right? And additionally, there's a specific on-state resistance is also function of voltage, and it is e to the power 3 reciprocal of the electric field. So specific on-state resistance is much, much less. So due to wider band gap and higher electric field, the devices are much thinner, and so the conduction losses are much, much less. Additionally, the thermal loading capability of the material is usually 5 to 10 times higher. So what that means, you can put for a given power, you can put 3 times more current, 4 times more current, 5 times more current, depending upon how you did. So what that means is overall the chip area is much, much smaller. So being a smaller chip means you have a smaller, you know, stray capacitance. And when you have a gate to source resistance, smaller drain to source resistance, and drain to gate resistance much smaller than the silicon semiconductor, then you can go and switch devices much, much faster frequency or faster rate, actually. I know our turn off time is much, much smaller, and that you can turn into switching the device at a higher frequency. And if you did higher frequencies, then you can reduce the size of passive components like inductor, capacitor, and all that. So you know that device has a less thermal conduct, you know, less lossage, and it switches very high frequency. So that's two main attributes, and then some are here. So essentially what happens, the large band gap result into relatively, you know, low intrinsic carrier concentration. So these charge carriers are that when you have not applied the control signal, you applied only power voltage between drain and source, some of the electron can break down from valence band and end up in conduction band of the semiconductor chip. So because of that, you may form what you call leakage current. So since the carrier concentration, intrinsic carrier concentration much, much less, so because of that, you can go higher temperature. Or for a given volt, in a given temperature, you can have a less leakage current, or given leakage current, you can operate higher temperature. So there's another property of the device called as a high temperature operation, right? And then fourth property is high thermal conductivity, particular silicon carbide. So these four unique properties, which are very, very pronounced as compared to silicon semiconductor, are making silicon carbide, and three unique property in case of gallium nitride making it far better semiconductor than silicon based, you know, devices, IGBT, MOSFET, and all that. So due to that, silicon carbide gallium nitride devices enable more efficient, lighter, smaller form factor powertrains operating at a high frequency and elevated temperature with reduced cooling. So this is uniqueness. I like to acknowledge, this slide I borrowed from my friend, Victor Belliardis. Victor is a director of Power America Institute, which is Department of Energy funded institute, $140 million funding for power electronics, advanced power electronics work in US. Victor came with me in India, actually, and he planned on coming again, and he likes to visit Kerala. He loved Kerala beach. So maybe that would be our next trip. So I like to acknowledge Isik Khejiali to get the data for this slide. So essentially, before wide bandgap devices came out, either you can have very high power or you can switch power converter high frequency. You can't do both simultaneously. But with wide bandgap devices, now you can switch converter high power. You can have a high power converter switch at high frequency. So due to that unique property of gallium nitride silicon carbide, now there are a lot of unique applications. And they were possible before also, but not in cost effective space, or you may have very, very large size converter all that. So now you can miniaturize the power converter, requiring less metals, less material, less plastic, less semiconductor. Is that's what is going to be enabling the carbon neutral economy by 2050, right? In Paris Accord, a lot of countries are signatures, including India, right? So that's why we want to make these converters smaller. So by making converter smaller, you are needing less copper, less aluminum, less plastic and things like that. So if you less material, and these materials are carbon intensive, so production of these material per inverter, carbon footprint produced by per inverter, if it is going down, which is good for society. So that's why I think that's another huge benefit of wide bandgap devices. So as an engineer, you must care for society, right? So you need to offer a solution that's good for society. So wide bandgap technology advantages are unique property of silicon carbide. You can go higher voltage, that gives you high, high power density. Means if you double the voltage, converter size should go down by 4 times. So that's a benefit. Frequency gives improved bandwidth, means you can respond to the operator command much, much faster manner. Temperature makes the high temperature property makes the cooling system. Maybe possibly you can design air cool converter, like thumb rule is that silicon based power converter, you can go up to 10 kilowatt, maybe air cooled. And after that, you have to resort to liquid cooling. In silicon carbide, you can go, I'm working on technology, you can go up to 100 kilowatt without requiring any liquid cooling, and it still do not compromise size and all that, and still keep converter size very, very small. Thermal conductivity, improved thermal loading, like a peak loading, sudden 10 second loading and all that is much, much better. And then advanced thermal management, allows that. So basically the material has a property to give the heat very, very fast to the heat cooling system, as long as you provide a very advanced cooling. So you can exploit the property of thermal conductivity. And then another thing benefit of these two material, gallium nitride silicon carbide, is hardened towards the radiation. So cosmic radiation, benign failure of the device is much, much susceptible because ability to operate high temperature and wider band gap, So there are a lot of, actually there is one PhD thesis I was reading, somebody did PhD in Germany that just on this topic itself, so there is a lot of knowledge out there that how these devices are much hardened towards, cosmic radiation. And then higher critical temperature. So like silicon semiconductor, if chip temperature goes above 500 degrees C, you are done. You just cannot basically damage. In silicon carbide, you can go up to 1000 degrees C and then still keep the operational. Of course, you cannot continuously operate 1000 degrees C, but momentarily localized temperature can go as high as 1000 degrees C and still you don't have any problem of thermal runaway. So these unique property have allowed very unique devices that allow me and John Deere, Deere and Company to develop 115 degrees C coolant power electronics. So ambient operating temperature of the inverter that I have designed for Deere is 130 degrees C. Water boils at 100 degrees C, right? So it's much higher than the boiling temperature of the water. And then also because of high temperature, we were able to simplify vehicle architecture. So I will acknowledge Rome's. I just took this slide from one of their presentations. So this is comparison. There's a lot of detail. I'm not going to read that. But silicon MOSFET versus silicon carbide, since distance traveled from drain to source is much less, that's why it has a lot less, unstate loss as compared to what you call silicon semiconductor. If silicon IGBT is a bipolar device, silicon carbide MOSFET is unipolar. So because of this, carrier life, recombination time and all that is not a problem, right? You can swept away charge carrier very easily from the channel, bring them back, so that's why this device operates at much faster rate than this device. Then these are the characteristics because of the bipolar nature of the IGBT, like a hole and electrons. You get pretty much like a diode type of characteristic, but in silicon carbide, since it is a unipolar device, so you get very linear characteristic like this. At zero voltage, you get almost zero current, zero voltage drop at a given gate voltage, and with the temperature also, right? So essentially what happens at some point, at the elevated temperature, like 150 degrees C, you will find that it may happen that IGBT may begin to get better. Like if you have a chip that is rated, let's say operating at a 10 ampere, right? But it is rated, let's say 30, 25 ampere. So you may see that IGBT is better, right? If you look at 25 ampere, IGBT has less drop than the MOSFET did. 1200 volt MOSFET also 1200 volt IGBT. But the problem is that you will never operate at this, because if you look at the vehicle application, particularly car, most of the time it is partial loading. That's what matters. So you may be only operating converter 30% load, but you may be needing 100% peak power, because that's so during acceleration, braking, and all that stuff. So you may not be operating here. So if you have a load that you are continuously high load, then maybe still silicon IGBT would be better. The problem is that size-wise, chip size is about 4 or 5 times larger than the silicon carbide. So if you don't care for size, probably silicon IGBT are better than the silicon carbide MOSFET. That's what kind of message of this slide is. And then during the third quadrant operation, means when the current is going opposite, you turn on the gate and you can operate it. Channel will be available to you. So a given current, silicon IGBT has higher voltage drop compared to silicon carbide until maximum operating current. And then these are switching characteristic, so essentially what happens, IGBT has a problem of tail current, and the reason it is tail current because of the charge carrier. It's a bipolar device, right? So you have to recombine all the charge carrier electron holes. So if you did not, then you cannot turn on the complementary device. But in silicon carbide, it is a unipolar device, right? That's why there is no such issue. Tail current is almost negligible. And the rate of rise, dV by dt, di by dt, is about 10x higher than the silicon IGBT. So certainly device designed, our material, actually not device, material is good for high frequency. This material, as compared to this material, is good for low frequency operation. And then over the temperature, gate voltages and all that. So this slide communicates the message that you want to operate at a higher gate voltage, right? And then the RDS on, it's function of gate voltage and temperature. So you want to operate them at 20 volt so that you have less voltage drop. That's highly depending on the gate voltage. So if you go 15 volt, then you have 25% more losses there, and that's not good. So operating, that's one debate happening out there. Should these devices be designed 20 volt? Should be designed 15 volt? Reliability, gate oxide reliability, and things like that. A lot of work is happening. A lot of standards are being written. Try to operate device as cool as possible. If you did that, then RDS on would be much, much less. And thermal loading is about 10 times higher. So take the advantage of thermal loading of the silicon carbide material than silicon. So by this time, now you know that cell structure, cell density alters the on-state resistance, so how the channel is designed, right? So higher cell density lowers the RDS on, so which is inverter gate devices. Good for inverter application, because in inverter, usually you don't switch very high frequency. For electric vehicle, 10 kilohertz, 5 kilohertz is good enough, right? You don't need to go hundreds of kilo unless you care for losses in electric machine. So people are working on soft switch inverter up to 100 kilowatt. And by soft switching, you have less dB by dT, insulation issues and all that are much less versus if it's a hard switch inverter. An interdigitated gate structure basically optimize distribution of current. So you don't have a localized hot spot and thermal runaway issue. And cell design optimized for short circuit robustness is basically, so what happens, the short circuit resistance capability is better. And then, you know, converter grade devices, like I'm sure you guys may have heard about inverter grade, converter grade, you know, thyristors, MOSFETs and all that, IGBT. So essentially it is basically altering the BGS, means the threshold voltage versus the channel resistance, right? In IGBT, it is on state voltage drop versus what you call, you know, threshold voltage. So RE on and E off, you know, you alter, right? So if you have low switching losses, then you are likely to have higher conduction losses. And if you have a higher conduction losses, then you are likely to have low switching losses. So in converter grade, actually what happens, converter switching at a much high frequency, like hundreds of kilohertz. So you want to make sure that the switching losses are minimal. Conduction losses you compromise, right? In inverter grade, you are switching at a much, much slower frequency. So you want to make sure conduction losses are minimal. But switching loss, you can compromise, or you can switch soft switch converters and all that. So what is key differences? Maybe there will be repeat here. High temperature is a property that design makes in converter. High temperature engine coolant converter. Our inverter are liquid cool, right? So if you run engine coolant through it, you can go up to 113 degrees C coolant flowing through it. So, and then if you are engine coolant, then you get rid of a lot of cooling pump, radiator, fan, hoses and all that, you know, and that helps make the vehicle reliability go up, you know, that never breaks. Frequency helps, you know, reducing passive component, voltage helps you, power density improvement, it is good idea to deliver power by voltage rather power by current. Thermal conductivity helps you designing the better thermal management. Critical temperature helps you about more headroom for, you know, what you call the thermal loading and peak loading and all that. Lower RDS on makes it converter and cool and also efficient. So now I will drill down to Power America project. So I brought about $6 million from DOE and John Deere puts about close to $8 million funding to do this project. So at that time, we were given very aggressive goal in 2014 timeframe. This technology did not exist then. Actually, Tesla, that Model 3 car has a silicon carbide inverter. So they may be working, but that wasn't public knowledge by then. So 200 kilowatt, we go 1000 volt, 1050 volt DC bus. And it need to be efficient, it need to be smaller in size, smaller in weight, power density should be 25 kilowatt per liter. So at that time we were doing about 9 kilowatt per liter type electronics. So we wanted to go at least double, more than double. Then we also wanted to do, as compared to conventional drivetrain, we want to have less fuel consumption. And additionally, we wanted to make sure that we run inverter at engine coolant, 115 degrees C coolant, so we get rid of cooling system. So in this vehicle, actually, there are a bunch of cooling system. One is for transmission oil cooling system, another one engine cooling system, third one is inverter, and if you put battery, there is cooling system for battery. And each cooling system has its own, you know, complexity. So if you get rid of one cooling system, you are basically making vehicle manufacturing and, you know, field, you know, experience all that far better. So silicon carbide is advanced and emerging technology for off-road vehicle. In fact, in off-road application, I don't see anyone has in the world tried such a technology except John Deere. So there's a risk being new and first in the field, and supply chain issues are there. But if you work, you sort out these challenges, you know, oftentimes sleepless nights, right? But then it gives you very, very competitive advantage and innovation, you know. So I have about 520 patents out of the project work I did for this project. So technology and about out of 20, 15 patents are already approved. So WBG technology objective. So we were given very aggressive goals. So they say Department of Energy, which is US, you know, funding agency, that said that, yeah, you have a 9 kW/L converter. A little later, you will see the picture of those converter. Why don't you go more than 25, right? Sign very aggressive goal. So began three generation of inverter development, Gen 0, Gen 1, and Gen 3. Our Gen 2 inverter is actually 43 kW/L. So we exceeded this goal. Then efficiency, two-stage power conversion, power take and power out, power generated by generator, power taken by motor. You know, two-stage power converter efficiency should be more than 97%. We met that goal also. Our Gen 1 inverter and so a Gen 2 inverter, 98% and higher, and also that to over the coolant. Whether you run 25 degree coolant or you run the, what you call the 115 degrees coolant, efficiency is always very high, max load efficiency. Then engine coolant operation. So we tested our Gen 1 inverter at 100, we tested up to 90 degree coolant and extrapolated the data up to 105 degree. And we found that the junction temperature of the devices would be 165 degrees at the max power. So 150 kilowatt operation, right? But Gen 2 inverter, we tested. This is by extrapolation, this is by test. So we did 115 degrees coolant flowing through it for hours and hours and hours and have 150 kilowatt power and junction remain 145 degrees. So you may be asking here that I jump the coolant by 10 degree, but the junction temperature dropped by 20 degree. And the reason is that we did very exotic cooling system. You remember I told that the silicon carbide has a very unique property, which is thermal conductivity. So we really took the advantage of thermal conductivity. It is 5 times better than our production inverter. So a good power electronics engineer must understand materials, must understand mechanical, must understand thermal and all that, right? So I guided my team to take the advantage of the thermal conductivity. And then of course we have to do what you call cost parity, because nobody's going to buy this thing because there is silicon carbide. So we are working on, and basically at the system level, silicon carbide inverter would be cheaper than the silicon IGBT. And my basically gut feeling is by 2030-2035 time frame, silicon IGBT will be phasing out. People will switch over to silicon carbide. So here is the basically inverter power density progression and capability progression. So this is called as PD550 inverter. So PD stands for power drive, 550 stands for 550 ampere current continuously this inverter can supply. There are two inverter and then electric braking system packaged together in this box. It weighs about 70 kilogram, 9 kW/L power density, 700 volt bus and 70 degree coolant. And it went into production in 2013. So this is actually, I design electronics, power stage and all that for this inverter, gate drive, starting right from 2007. So it took about 5 years. It takes about 5 to 6 years to design such a product like this. And then we designed what you call PD400. We improved power density a little bit, but did much more improvement in the cost and size and weight and all that. So weight of this is about 38 kilogram. It also has electric braking. Then this is our Gen 1 inverter. Then we pack more power, 18 kW/L. Remember our goal was 25 kW/L. One of the things that help us go higher power density, increasing the DC bus voltage from 700 volt to 1050 volt. And then Gen 2 inverter, we got 43 kW/L. And the reason behind it is because of the packaging, inverter packaging, thermal management, all that help us. So this inverter, listen what I'm going to say. This inverter uses 13,000 microfarad capacitor. 13,000 microfarad. This is a 2,000. So these are electrolytic capacitor. These are film capacitor. Whatever job this silicon IGBT inverter do, same job this inverter doing, but doing at a 440 microfarad. So think about capacitor size as compared. This is gone down by 5x as compared this many, many fold, and is still doing the job. So there were a lot of improvement in the control we did. Remember, I told you high switching frequencies of bandwidth and all that. So we designed very advanced control system for this inverter. So in my team, there were control engineer, hardware, power, mechanical, all that, right? So I guided them to do this work. So then all these inverters have are 400 kilowatt if you parallel output. If not, then there are two inverter, dual inverter means two inverter back to back on a common DC bus, the electric braking. And all of them are doing same job, right? But then look at this one. So 70 kilogram, about 38 to about 20 kilogram to under 9 kilogram. So think about in carbon neutral economy, right? You are doing same job, but lot less material, right? It is very, very important for natural capital, which are materials, right? That you are mining from the earth. You mine less material. It's good for environment, sustainability, good for future generation people to come, right? So three generation of silicon carbide inverter were tested in the lab, modularity useful for many applications, because now this inverter gotten so small that because we don't sell 1 million vehicle, right? We sell all the vehicle put together. John Deere may be selling 1 million, but there are many, many hundreds of vehicle farm, right? So if one water design and it is being used for main tractor loaders, mining machine, harvesting machines, you know, forestry machine, that's what we are trying to do. Increasing power density gives competitive advantage. Reason is that because when this inverter came along, we used to take in trade shows, you know, like a customer facing, you know, events. And then they were asking this. Moment this came, they said, no, we don't want, we want this. Now they're asking this, right? It's because everybody likes a smaller thing. So that's why it gives you competitive advantage, decreasing base size and form factor. It's very easy to integrate. Now aspiration is that we are going to put inverter motor together and we are going to eliminate connector, cable, shielding, all that aspect, right? And this that both are enjoying same cooling, like both are transmission fluid cooled. So get rid of liquid cooling, right? Water cooling. So those are the further innovation that we are trying to do. So improve performance, high temperature gives system benefits. So just to give you the idea that in US, per household energy electricity consumption is 10 kilowatt hour per day. So this inverter handles roughly 40 houses worth electricity. Now imagine the transformer or service station in your neighborhood in India. You know, think about like a size of that structure, electric grid, versus this inverter that you can just handheld on one hand, right? So this is huge, has a huge power handling capability. So why heavy duty vehicle, off-road vehicle are so different? The reason is requirement near zero speed operation, stall torque. Because our vehicle, you are going forward, backward, you are stopping, and you are doing near zero speed operation of powertrain. It's a highly taxing, not good for electronics. So this is 644 architecture. So we have engine that drive the generator, that we put electricity in the converter, then drive the electric machine, and then we burn some of the electricity in this power register, right? So engine coolant capable powered and silicon carbide inverter could significantly simplify vehicle architecture, because cooling pump by electric cooling system of inverter run by electrical pump, and oftentimes that's what fails. So we want to get rid of that failure. But failure is not option, right? So three generation of silicon carbide inverter. So essentially this is our Gen Zero inverter. So when I got this funding, right, DOE funding, I had no idea I never even seen the Silicon Carbide in 2014-15. So I said, you know, what to do, how to basically go about doing, or this is highly risky technology, I don't want to fail. So we said, okay, let's do something that we know the better, right, as compared to anyone else. So we said, okay, let's take this silicon IGBT inverter, not worry about, you know, housing development and all that for the inverter. Let's do some impactful work. So we took this one, we found the power module that can retrofit this in silicon IGBT, and we developed the gate drive, our own gate drive, right? And then it's very, very, gate drive need to be nicely done. Otherwise you are set for failures. Then we developed the 1100 volt rated capacitor module, which looks like this. These were handmade in here, in the ISG Fargo. And then we also tested 690 volt permanent magnet machine. So we provided, because before that 700 volt inverter, so machine was 460 volt rated. So we took 460 volt machine, but tested up to 690 volt and provided supplier to DVYDT, rise time, over voltage and all that, and did insulation coordination so that when the machine is being operated at 1050 volt, it never run into risk of failure, corona discharge, partial discharge, those problems we solve. We also tell DVYDT filter, because oftentimes I was told that the switching edges of the devices would be such a fast that can be detrimental to machine insulation. Maybe common mode current voltage issue, you may run into those risks, or you may have so noisy that your micro and DSP and FPGA can hang up. So you need to have a DVYG filter. So we tested that, and what we found that for ground vehicle, if cable length between inverter motor less than 12 feet, whether you use with silicon carbide inverter, you never need DVYDT filter. But for aerial vehicle, aircraft and all that, you need DVYDT filter because of the safety regulation by government. Benchtop back-to-back motor dyno testing we did. So with new knowledge in wide band gap silicon carbide gallium nitride, within 10 months, we were spinning the electric machine. So I call it success, because if you are set for failure and if you are about to fail on new technology development work, it's a good idea to fail fast and move on versus keep digging, you know. See, for companies, they should never care for money. What they should care for, time. If they launch the product, first product introduction in the market, they by being first, you grab 60% market. So time is essence. If you lose the time, then you are basically not good, right? So if you are working on a risky technology and you are likely to fail, it's a good idea to find very early on and move on versus keep pouring resources, money and all that and found it very late and then, oh, sorry. Yeah. So you lost a lot of valuable time, right? So that was my motivation to do that very fast, rapid development. Then we went on, did Gen 1 inverter. We did very low inductance bus bar. One of the things that power trans engineer often say that I'm going to put a snubber capacitor. I'm going to put a decoupling capacitor to control the voltage. That's a very bad approach. You want to do very good packaging work and never need any snubber capacitor. Because think about, if you have 130 degree ambient condition, you have to have at least 140, 150 degree C component where you will find. And even if you found them, they are very costly. So if you do very good packaging work and have a stray inductance, much less, then you don't need. Additionally, it is good for motor also. So think about, like, we were setting up about 800 ampere current and we were seeing only 10 volt overshoot. So this is turn off event, this is turn on event. And I was very, very surprised. So the inductance is less than, actually we measured it at 0.5 nano Henry. So power module supplier, all that, we guided them. This is our needs are for density improvement we did from, you know, from the other inverter, this to this inverter a 10 kilowatt per liter and also be tested at 250 kilowatt power and, you know, 105 degrees C coolant operation was basically verified before putting inverter on the vehicle. So this was the power modules. This bent into Gen 0 inverter means retrofitted silicon IGBT inverter. So we took silicon IGBT inverter, retrofitted with silicon carbide power module, and then we developed the Gen 1 inverter with silicon carbide, you know, mindset. So essentially, if you look at here, we were turning off 1000 ampere current at 1000 volt, and we were seeing roughly 350 volt overshoot. So this is very, very bad thermocene insulation. It generates a lot of common voltage, common mode current and all that. So you have to do very good shielding, and it may have EMI, EMC. So, but with the nicely done inductance and all that, with low inductance, we have no overshoot. Internal, this is basically the what is reverse recovery current, but that's internal to power module. So then no problem. The machine cares for this problem versus this. And then we did a lot of characterizations, a lot of testing, say 690 volt machine testing, back-to-back dyno up to 90 degree coolant testing, then extrapolated data that should, you know, 105 degree C coolant flow through the inverter, what happens, efficiency measurement and all that. When we felt confident, this is the inverter we put on the vehicle for testing. Our Gen 2 inverter was basically because of this module. So this is a basically only module exists in the world that's what developed by GE Aviation. And so in 2016 or 17, I don't remember exactly the year, Deer and Company management had about $500,000. And they said, yeah, can you do something with this money? I said, yeah, give it to me. I'll make a module. So I hired GE Aviation, and they have their own semiconductor technology from GE Research Center in New York. And they packaged this module. So there are all the six MOSFETs are packaged here. And then not only that, output terminals are integrated, and then they are done in such a way that I can put coreless current sensor. So I miniaturize current sensor, miniaturize power module, gate drive, all that. Also we eliminated bolted joints. So this is DC plus DC minus terminal. We no longer bolted, we have a clamp on. You press down the bus bar and apply enough pressure, spring loading type effect, if you will, and then you don't need bolted joint. My experience is that in an inverter, oftentimes bolted joint, that's what fails because of the not being torqued properly or over time that connection is degrading, all that. So if you eliminate bolted joint, that's good for reliability aspect. So anyway, so then we went about doing develop this module, 700 volt, 1700 volt, 250 ampere rated. 400 ampere volt DC, ampere DC. So we need to provide DC and AC rating of this module. Why DC is important? Because of near zero speed operation. At zero speed, it's all DC current. So you need to be mindful about DC rating as well as AC rating. Both inverter on same side. Now this module has gotten so small, then we put one inverter here, another inverter here, and these are outputs. So these are AC, phase ABC, phase ABC for generator traction. And these are basically the midpoint and DC plus DC minus for electric braking. And control board is here. So this is a compartment wide design. So what I'm trying to say here, that you may have 130 degree ambient powertronics and you may have a 55 ambient powertronics nicely coexisting together, right? And not bothering each other. So that is the trick here in this inverter. So both inverter on same side, low inductance between both inverter, because if inductance is low, then you can put the, you know, the fast transfer of power from generator to traction machine, traction to generator machine, and then also easier manufacturing. Now it's such a small inverter, it's very easy to put on the vehicle. And then power density. So that was the goal, that 25 kilowatt per liter. So we exceeded that goal. So this is comparison Gen 1 versus Gen 2, and you know the, this have gotten so small. And additionally, this module comes in two flavors. This is 1700 volt blocking and 1200 volt blocking with no change whatsoever. So essentially, you can have this inverter, 700 volt DC bus inverter, 1050 volt DC bus inverter. You can have single inverter, dual inverter with braking, electric braking. So by doing so, we have so many flavors of inverter, and this can be useful for many, many vehicles. Then another thing, we do a lot of characterization at high current over the temperature. So we test power module minus 40 degrees C to 105 degrees C, because gate drive may work good, fantastic at 25 degrees C. It may fail to work at negative temperature or very high temperature. So you want to be mindful for that, and you want to basically test. So these modules do not have any Schottky diode, like IGBT. You know, IGBT is anti-parallel diode, MOSFET relies on body diode, which comes because of built-in structure of this. So want to make sure that body diode doesn't have a sloppy behavior. So that only you can screen that at very high current. And these are power current. We can, if I want to produce 250 kilowatt power, I must be operating about 250 ampere type current, you know, so that's what this testing was. So here is a comparison of these three inverter, Gen 0, Gen 1, and Gen 2. Now you see how progression of these, and then here, these are cables. So here it takes a whole lot of effort to put the cable in these, you know, 360 degree shielding and all that. By the way, dear customer was named Pressure Was. So there's a 700 volt bus there, and you have a high power voltage, high voltage. Still, they put, you know, 60 psi, you know, water spraying on this. So you want to make sure that these are nicely sealed, right? Otherwise, you may destroy the electronics. So this Gen 1 inverter got a little bit simpler, but this one is so easy to connect these cables. Though individual, but so easy. I'm like, if I want to plug these cables, probably I will take half an hour to 45 minutes here. Probably I will take maybe 20 minutes here. I can get done in 10 minutes. So that's kind of manufacturing advantage. And then there is a video here. So essentially, this video is about, National Renewable Energy Laboratory was, you know, working with me, and they put this video on this. So it's pretty interesting to know internal detail, you know, and I can maybe I can still, you know, share and pause. And so essentially, at least some video is coming about the so this is like a high temperature. This is comparison between silicon versus silicon carbide. Packaging aspect. Power module with integrated thermal management system. Partial load efficiency much higher. Current sensor technology improvement. We are cooling these bus bar, right? So these bus bar that are coming, so making sure that the heat that goes cannot travel back from motor to inverter, right? So we are cooling these. That's what. This is basically nicely laminated bus bar. So these are the things I was telling you, clamp on, right? So the eliminated bolted joint, but they clamp it, press it down. So there's no bolted joint, a lot of surface area that helps us to mitigate thermal issue at the contact, you know, of the DC plus DC minus. Anyway, you guys can look at that. So let's continue the presentation. Okay, there was a question. Let me see if I can answer. Why don't I take them when I'm done? I'll do it there. So, okay, so we then put this thing in the John Deere, you know, 6x4 loader. And we put the right here, we needed to do some changes, cooling system and all that. And then 100 saw power, we drove on the vehicle and not any issue. We were very pleased to the success. So this is production vehicle, you can buy it in the US. I think we sell this in the US and Canada. So there are two countries right now, we are selling these vehicles. We plan on selling them in Europe, but looks like some different model. And then the Gen 1 inverter, so this the changes we did here. Gen 2 wasn't tested on the vehicle, but it was tested right on the lab. So some lessons, basically silicon IGBT mindset doesn't work. You want to exploit the benefit of silicon carbide. You know, turn off energy are much less. You need to pay attention to our voltage issue, connector, cable, electric machine, common mode voltage, common mode current, bearing current, EMI, EMC, all that. And if you did that, you will get very good product. So then we did, we do this kind of work very often, multi-machine, multi-inverter, even six machine, six inverter setup. I have run for this project. What that means is pretty much vehicle can be simulated in the live environment. And so when I say simulation means I'm not saying that you are doing some MATLAB simulation. I'm saying experimentation, simulation by experimentation. You can simulate vehicle condition in the live environment. So first inverter, like a outer inverter or silicon IGBT inverter and inner or silicon carbide. So these two inverter together pretty much simulate like a engine driven PM generator. And then there's no DC bus here, DC source here, right? So this is the how I figured out that 444 microfarad capacitor is good enough. So this produces no DC bus and supports itself under dynamic condition. And then these two inverter together, motor together pretty much simulate traction system. And the last stage of this thing is power is circulated. Right, so power flows like this. So, you know, electric power turns into mechanical power, then mechanical power turns into electric, then electric power turns into mechanical, and then mechanical power turns back to electric. So power is circulating this, but since it has a losses, so that loss is coming from the power supply. So this is how the setup looks like. You know, so these are the, you know, 690 volt permanent PM machines. And then there are two machines here. So these two, this inverter is silicon IGBT inverter, PD400 inverter with electric brake. This inverter driving these machines, and this inverter, silicon carbide inverter driving these machines. And we have cooling system, aisle machines are aisle cooled, inverter are water cooled. So all that is given here. So then in this vehicle, day long, you know, operator doing 20 kilowatt, high power, low power, continuously. Every in 2 minutes, it happens 4 or 5 times. So we want to test it in that condition. So 20 kilowatt, then throw the 165 kilowatt power and see if DC bus remains stable. Indeed, it is stable. And then, you know, high speed, like 3,000 RPM to 6,000 RPM. And you know, so we found no issue here, right? So DC bus doesn't collapse, it remains stable. There's a certainly sag, no doubt about it, for about 10-15 milliseconds, but DC bus recovers after the condition is gone, the transient condition is gone. And then we tested Gen 2 inverter, 30 to 150 kilowatt, 150 back to 30 kilowatt, no issue that everything remain. And this was very important because you remember we thinned down capacitor from 13,000 microfarad to 440, PD550 to, you know, Gen 2 silicon carbon inverter or PD400 inverter, 2000 microfarad film capacitor to electrolytic, right? So we wanted to make sure that we are thinning it size wise. So we want to make sure that it doesn't lead to DC bus collapsing, right? So that's what this was the reason. Then we put this thing on the vehicle. So there's a YouTube video on this. You guys can look at it. And then when we felt confident, we hosted Department of Energy, which is a funding agency. So this gentleman is Lee Gentin. I'm like, I have very high respect for him. His name is L. Hafner. So when I was doing PhD in IIT Delhi, I used to read his research paper. He's a material scientist, should do device and all that. So Victor, who came with me to India, you know, so Victor is Power America Executive Director, CTO, and L. Hafner, DOE Program Manager. Laura Marlino is a DOE scientist, and, you know, Powell is DOE consultant. Lockheed Martin, my friend, he's a virtual ELM. ELM is known for making this F-16 and all these fighter, right? F-35 fighter, I think they are defense company. So he also came to, you know, drive the vehicle, me, and then Kevin Binion, who is a scientist in DOE, National Renewable Energy Laboratory. Look at the tire of this vehicle, like almost all of them are, you know, height-wise, you know, only Kevin probably is matching to the tire height. And they drove 9-foot-4 loader, they drove 6-foot-4 loaders. It was fun event. So then we operate, it's operating in various modes. So there's YouTube video, and, you know, when you watch it, you should pay attention to tire slippage and all that. So I'm not going to play, but just watch it. Okay, so I'm just about to down. So we did 25 to 115 degrees C coolant and 75 ambient and 90 minutes. So we found no issue, but what we found that beyond 90 degree, gate drive was heating too much. So we couldn't go, you know, so we tested 115. Then after that, we needed to do derating, right? So with 55 ambient, 115 degrees C coolant, we can only operate inverter 60 kilowatt on each side, right? So from 150 to 60 kilowatt derating. But then we did some treatment, and after that, we can continuously operate 115 degrees C coolant, 55 degrees C. What we did was that we put a thermal barrier, because power module, you know, 95% heat goes to the coolant, but remaining 5% rises up and can heat the electronics. So you want to make sure that heat doesn't come closer to, you know, gate drive electronics. That's what treatment we did. So after that, it was good. So we needed to pay attention to targets. Power density, we found there's improvement. By the way, Department of Energy goal 2025 is 100 kilowatt per liter. So when they knew that John Deere got this far, so they jack up their goal to 100 kilowatt per liter. Their 2020 goal was 13 kilowatt per liter, right? So imagine that when they are saying funding some, you know, research project, they want to ask you to do aggressive, you know, targets, you know, type goal you need to achieve. And then also the engine coolant. So Gen 1 was tested 105 degree coolant. Gen 2 were designed and tested 90, but Gen 2 were designed for 115 degrees C coolant and tested 115 degrees C coolant. And then also the efficiency we measured is always higher than 98%. And cost parity, basically, even if I pay 3 times more for devices, let's say I buy silicon IGBT $100, silicon carbide MOSFET $300, is still at system level, silicon carbide solution would be cheaper. So this slide is very good, you know, comparisons. Imagine that these are two competing technologies, silicon IGBT and silicon covered MOSFET. So silicon carbide MOSFET inverter, you are designing 200 kilowatt, 1050 volt, same thing, silicon IGBT. You can get performance, you can get capability, but movement, you want to go high temperature, then you need to derate IGBT quite a bit. So our experience is that whatever silicon carbide MOSFET do, 300 ampere MOSFET, to do same job at a high temperature coolant and high frequency, you need 900 ampere rating IGBT and huge. This is actually 5 times larger than this. So if you multiply dollar times MPa ampacity number, and if the number remain same, then you got it. You know, you can have two solutions. This could be a solution that you don't care for size. This could be a solution that you really care for material size, power density, and all that. So here are these two, right? You know, this module went into Gen 1. That's why I have Gen 1 picture. But I could put here Gen 2 picture and bring that six-pack power module. So we have quite a bit of experience. So our Gen 0 inverter power module looks like, say, silicon IGBT retrofitted. Then this is silicon covered power module, a la 1700 volt blocking. And then this is six-pack power module, our Gen 2 inverter. So we have very, you know, quite a bit experience, and dual sourcing of devices is very, very important. Reason is that because think about like in Japan, Fukushima, that reactor broke and John Deere factory were down because there was a couple of suppliers were in Japan. So there's one risk mitigation group in D&M company. Their whole day job is to make sure that if we are buying part from somewhere in the world, same part we can buy. Like let's say we buy something from India, right? Can we buy same part from Argentina? So if something happens in India or Argentina, then same thing may not happen in India. So things like that. So we want to make sure the supply is not interrupted. And I don't know how much you guys are up to speed on the news, but General Motors has shut down its plant for 2 weeks. Because of the interruption of the supply chain. And this is due to fuel shortage in UK and electricity shortage in China. And this year, unusual weather conditions various places in the world. So because of that, supply chain of electronic component is very much stressed out. Additionally, the prices of the product that are needing electronics has gone up 40% in US. So if you want to go buy car, buy refrigerator, television, all that, expect paying 40% more money. And this is because of the supply chain disruption. Technology innovation by 9C solutions. So we reduce capacitor by 5 times, cost by 10 times, coolant 70 degree to 115 degrees C. Coolant connector, simpler, cost-effective, easier for shielding case. We improved the size of inverter much better. So smaller inverter, advanced control, coreless current sensor, smaller cable, low copper content, and overall much better cost at system level. So in summary, silicon carbide power times is real. Early adopter liked it to niche application. Very unique application that can pass on value prop of the technology. By 2025, silicon carbide MOSFET will compete with silicon IGBT. And by 2020 time frame, we had about 3,500 hour field experience, and we are taking the technology to production. So by 2025, 2026 time frame, John Deere will be putting out tractors that will have a silicon carbide inverter in them. Cost reduction for silicon carbide power devices need to happen. So 3x cost parity are better. Innovation by 9C solution, I already explained what are those 9C. And I like to acknowledge Department of Energy for funding this project. And, National Renewable Energy Laboratory for, working with me on the thermal management simulation, all that. Power America management to pass the funding through them, and of course John Deere management, my team in Deere. Without them, I just cannot do this work. They needed guidance, which I did. And sometime I also work in the lab. So if you want to contact me, this is my contact, you know, email, you can write me, just remind that you attended this lecture and I would be happy to answer any question you have. Looks like you already asked. Will share recorded video to attending. Yeah, of course, I will. Oh, you will share, Satish, yeah. Yeah, that's fine, thanks. So let me try answering some of the questions. So
I will read out the question, sir. Satish Kumar, I will read out the question, sir.
I couldn't hear you. Could you clear? Go ahead, Satish. Say one more time.
Is that?
Somebody was saying something. Please talk clearly. I couldn't hear it. Hello. Okay. So I'm you are asking some question. Who is asking some question?
From the chat window, shall I read the questions?
Yeah, okay. I can read it because right. I have it open here.
Okay.
So right. How is the thermal management carried out in hybrid loader? What are the junction temperature limits in the power semiconductor? How it compares with those just silicon power devices? So thermal management inverters are liquid cool, okay? And we design basically in the Gen 2 inverter, we have eliminated a lot of thermal layer, means the coolant is in direct contact. Actually, I'm just putting these questions here. So inverter is in direct contact with the cooling, right? If you remember, I was showing that video, maybe let me go here. Yeah, see here? So this is power module. And we directly, so we have a channel, mini channel, and we have mini manifold. So essentially we are routing the coolant. So coolant goes like this, and then it has a jet effect, like you are, you know, and then it falls in the, you know, in next channel, right? So essentially we are going parallel flow of the coolant, and it targeting just underneath the chip. So we don't use any thermal paste and all that. So we have reduced thermal resistance by 1/4. So that would be my answer. So, okay, then what is the junction temperature? So limit is usually we like to remain 25 degree or less as compared to max junction temperature. The reason behind it is because of reliability. So in silicon IGBT inverter, 150 degrees C junction, we made sure that we never exceed more than 125. In silicon carbide, we plan on putting junction temperature roughly 145, 150 degrees C. And there is a temperature sensor. We have also real-time algorithm that compute the junction temperature, you know, cycle by cycle. So we take advantage of those. There are a lot of trade secret we have covered. Those are not public knowledge, but I'm giving a very high level idea how we do that. So it compares with those junction, how it compares those just silicon powered. Yeah, so certainly silicon carbide, you can take a little bit higher temperature because devices are 175 and also the allowed us to do, you know, very good cooling and all that because of thermal conductivity. Think about material is thinner and it has a 3 times higher thermal conductivity. So if you add these two together, then you are 9 times better, actually 9 to 12 times better as compared to silicon IGBT. So we took advantage of that. Daniel asked, silicon carbide has so many advantages. Why has it not been used? Why only now? The reason is that reliability was one issue, cost was another issue. So let me tell you Daniel paradigm of this thing. In 2012-13 time frame, if I tell any person, the any company that I want to buy, they just never tell me the cost. Oh, you can't afford it. And now people are selling these devices. So there's a lot of supply chain came around, a lot of work has been done. Power America certainly has changed the paradigm. Another thing is that management doesn't want to take risk. Anything that is working, right, then you do not, right? So I would basically give a lot of credit, of course, to work that Power America and I did. This project has been the one of the best performing project on the application side, said by, I was, because of first the success, I was invited to go White House actually in 2016, which I did not, because of the administration change, Obama versus Trump and all that. But anyway, what I'm saying, management doesn't want to take risk, right? So somebody has to basically have courage, and me being in a position that I was leading R&D team, so, and I have funding, so I did, and moreover, top of that, government gave some funding. So certainly adoption is increasing. One of them is solar energy, actually. Solar inverter are using silicon carbide. So by 2025, you will see a lot of silicon carbide based, vehicle out there. High temperature power devices, how do you take care that people do not suffer? Okay, so this is good question. So essentially these are 55 ambient, right? So external temperature is 55, right? And this thing is concealed. So it's not like that you people are going to touch. So let me show you, two vehicle, right? So this 944. So 944 loader, actually inverters are in the cabinet here. This is the cabinet, right? So this is actually here, right there. So you can stand on that cabinet. It is very sturdy, actually, but nobody can touch them. In 644, inverter is actually here. So it's nicely concealed, you cannot go and touch it per se, right? So yeah, so that would be my answer. Okay. So who are silicon? Okay, so there are basically Cree is one company in the US, Rome is another one, Infineon, Semicron, GE. So there are a lot of ST Micro. Mitsubishi. So there are a lot of company out there. What is the serviceability for field failure of your inverter? Is it module replacement of silicon powered component? SSD. So our experience is that this vehicle has been in the market for 20,000 hours, which is roughly 8 years. And we have no failure, right? So we design them not to fail. So now the question is that if let's say because some reason it fails, then John Deere part supplier called a PDC, part distribution center, have these inverters and we go and replace them. And then the failed inverter comes to us to see what happened. This I think you had when I was playing that video. We'll share recorded video too, okay? That's what. Certificate. Looks like somebody asking like a professional development hour. I have no idea what you mean by that. Feedback link will be shared soon, okay? That's, have you considered all electric solution eliminating diesel engine input supply from the medium voltage cable like in electric shovel in mining? Good question. So certainly shovel is a very different paradigm. The reason it is because, how many shovels per year people make, right? Very limited. And we don't want to go for say very high voltage because of safety reason and all that, because always they would be operating in shovel. Actually, I told some, coal mining company here in North Dakota, and I've seen the shovel, medium voltage electric shovel in the coal mining. It's a very safe place to be. Like it's like a power plant. If you tour power plant, how you go around, you know, all that, that's that type of structure they have. So safety versus, you know. So, but yeah, if you go high, these are locomotive vehicle, right? Certainly if you go high voltage, that's a helpful. E-certificate, okay, that's fine. Feedback, I request all, okay. So looks like, what about the short circuit? Okay, so short circuit protection. We do have short circuit protection, and what I have is basically sensing time. So within 70 nanosecond, I would come to know something's wrong, and within 1.5 microsecond, I would be able to respond. So we have very good sensing, you know, for the short circuit, and then followed by turning off. Single sourcing was discouraged. 8G aviation was sole source of signal. Then this a contradiction. Yes, it is contradiction, Daniel, but we are doing engineering development work at that time, and the production inverter that we are taking, we have dual source there. So looks like I answered most of the question. If anybody want to ask any additional question, I would be happy to answer, but I hope it was useful. And I hope you learned something from this presentation. So it was great. It's a pleasure to have you all here. I can hang on a few more minutes. It's already past 11 o'clock in night here, and I started my day 5 a.m. today. Maybe morning time, evening time in India works better for me, maybe. If we go next time and it's such event.
Participants, if you have any question, you can unmute and ask.
So can I ask one question?
Sure, please.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, so I asked that question about the short. Yeah, so I asked that question about the short circuit protection. So is it a DSAD protection that was used, or how it was?
Yeah, DSAD. Because silicon wire MOSFET doesn't have any DSAD. It's a resistance, right? So the IGBT have a very unique ability, right? The current through them will never go more than 4 times. Because they will build so high voltage, right? But a MOSFET will never build the voltage. It's IR, right? You know, basically I times R. So you keep building, you know, it will never block, right? So what it is, basically you basically see the how much voltage you afford, and then you decide, make decision. So that's what I did. So, you know, about 3 times, 2.5 times have nominal current. Where temperature was good enough.
So, but the difference in normal operating condition voltage that drop, and when you are actually in a short circuit mode, that difference may not be that much, right?
No, so, it is. It is. That's what I'm saying, you know, that IR, right? So basically R remains same, right? RDS on. So if I is rising, then voltage drop will rise. You know, so if let's say you have, think about like you can afford 1.5 or 2 volt drop, right? Nominal operating condition. But under short circuit, you can go 6 volt, but you cannot remain 6 volt for long time. You know, you need to detect it. So that detection time is 75 nanosecond. Okay.
Yes.
In a silicon IGBT, our detection time was 4-5 microseconds. So we are talking on nanosecond to microsecond, followed by we make decision that indeed it is a short circuit. Then within you know 1.5 microsecond we respond, and by the devices turn off within less than 100 nanosecond. So over the temperature testing of that, we found that was good enough.
One more question. Sorry. Is there any active gate drive used, or it was like a voltage source based gate drive?
Voltasource, actually Active Grid Drive, I'm listening, it's a very good university research and all that, but yes, I have not to date found anybody doing commercial inverter using Active Grid Drive.
Yes, it's okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome. So there was one question, have you evaluated IGBT device? No, I did not. From Toshiba, I did not. Okay, if no question, then I would request,
I would like to initiate the vote of thanks if there is no more questions.
Yeah, please.
Thank you very much, sir, for this really insightful session. The session was amazing and gave us the really good knowledge on this topic. And I hope every one of us here can agree on that. I would also like to use this opportunity to thank our college, New Horizon College of Engineering and Electrical and Electronics Department. I would also like to thank our principal, Manjunath sir, HOD of EEE, Dr. Mahesh, our branch advisor, Dr. Vinod Kumar, and our faculty, Dr. Satish Kumar sir, for giving us this opportunity in organizing this event. Lastly, I would like to thank all the participants for their support throughout the session and taking their time off to attend the webinar conducted by IEEE Power Electronics Student Branch Chapter NHCE. Thank you. We have posted the attendance and feedback link in the chat box. Kindly fill it to receive your certificate. Please do check your spam folder for the received certificate. Thank you all.
Thanks for having me, and I really enjoyed the question you guys asked, and it's great that, being away from Ma Bharati, this is my contribution to give away my motherland, if I could. And when I come to India, I visit a lot of engineering schools, so I try to interact with professors, students. Additionally, I guide a lot of students about whenever somebody writes me about how to go about doing master, PhD, helping them finding internship in US and job and all that. So anybody is willing to take some guidance, help from me, I would be very, very happy. There's no favor. I enjoy doing that. I feel like I got very low cost, very high quality education, but I was unlucky that I couldn't serve in motherland, Ma Bharati. So I like to, give some of this by doing things like this. Okay. Thank you all. Thanks, Satish, for being so successful with me. Lot of LinkedIn messages and all that, but eventually we got it done.
Yes, sir.
That's what matters most.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, all. You guys have a great day and great weekend.
Dear participants, if you are interested to join the Power Electronics Society, the promotion code I shared in the chat window. In case if you are already an IEEE member and wishing to join Power Electronics Society, I shared the promotion code in the chat window, PELSEDU. Thank you all. Thank you for participants, and thank you the speaker. Wonderful session. Thank you.
Thanks all. Bye.